Brother Newby, that brings with us different kinds of memories and so forth. And it's the day that we honor that man we used to think was so wrong. Anybody else with me? The honor that man we used to think was so horrifically wrong. Until we grew up and then suddenly that man became very wise, got very smart. He was incredibly intelligent and we laugh at the joke, but to be honest, the humor awakens in us all the reality that we have experienced of going through different stages of life. And I don't know about you, Brother Michael Peters, but when I traveled through that sophomoric stage of life, I did think that my father was out of touch and lacked the ability to connect with my generation. But from deep within all of us, we feel that among all the human relationships we experience in this life, there is something incredibly and awesomely unique about the relationship that takes place between a father and a child. There is something about a father-child relationship that runs very deep and that touches close to the very center, the very core of our lives. And when that relationship is good or great, it affects all of our lives. It affects every part of our life. And when that relationship is bad, it hurts. It causes pain and struggle. And it chips away at the joy and the love that we feel. And it even messes up some good parts in our lives. You can let a bad relationship between a father and a child ruin that child's marriage or ruin that child's parenting. And such is the power of the father and child relationship in God's world. And I want to share with you a probably often overlooked scripture. And turn with me, if you will, to Numbers chapter 26, verse 11. Nothing like preaching from the genealogies. It's kind of, you know, not where preachers take their text. But in Numbers 26, 11, the Bible says, notwithstanding, the children of Korah died not. The text that I read to you this morning is one of the census listings in the book of Numbers. And I don't know, but if you're like me, often we just read right on past this. Notwithstanding, the children of Korah did not die. They died not. And seemingly irrelevant, dropped in with all the other names so difficult to enunciate that we usually just read it and move on. And almost, Brett, if you will, we kind of, in our obligation to read the entire Bible, we kind of just speed read through this portion of the Bible. But this is one very short and remarkable and incredible verse that's just powerful. The children of Korah didn't die. And what makes this phrase so powerful and so significant is this. When you read the rest of the story concerning Korah in Numbers chapter 16, 10 chapters ahead of this, you find a man named Korah, along with some other men who gathered 250 influential people, and they led a rebellion against Moses and against Aaron. Korah, along with some other people, led a horrific rebellion against Moses. And so God split the ground wide open, and they and their families were swallowed alive by the earth there that day. The ground closed in around them just before God consumed the remaining 250 with fire. And when this story is briefly summarized later in our text in Numbers 26, it just adds one little note that says, notwithstanding, the children of Korah didn't die. We aren't told why they were spared from judgment, and it could be that the sons of Korah never went along with their father. Maybe they never participated in the rebellion, and it could be that they were aligned with their father, but when they were given the warning, they heeded the warnings, and they left his group realizing that their dad was making a tragic mistake. And maybe just at the last minute, they said, no, not I, and ran away. We don't really know. But in Numbers 16, 26, we do know that Moses warned them. He said, depart, I pray you, from the tents of those wicked men and touch nothing of theirs, lest you be consumed in all their sins. And so, Tyler, it's possible that they heard this warning and they said, I don't want to die this way and not today. And all we really know up to this point is when judgment came from God in Numbers 26:11, that the children of Korah did not die. Years later, however, we do read this, and we do read a little bit more about the sons of Korah. Because remember, the sons of Korah was a Levite. He was in the Levitical tribe, and so as a Levite, he had priestly duties. And so we have to remember that because of this, Korah's surviving sons, those who did not die, they're later assigned duties in the house of the Lord. First Chronicles 9:19 says, Shalom, the son of Korah, the son of whatever that guy's name is. Don't name your son that. The son of Korah and his brethren of the house of his father, the Korahites, they were over the work of the service, keepers of the gates of the tabernacle, and their fathers, being over the host of the Lord, were keepers of the entry. And if you read all of 1 Chronicles 26, especially verses 13 through 19, it tells us even more about the sons of Korah and other places and doing things. And they are mentioned in the titles of multiple psalms, at least 11 of them. And these titles are part of the psalms in the Hebrew text. And the remnant of the sons of Korah, they looked far into the future and they saw the salvation and the redemption of the Messiah. You can see, as you sing the psalms that the sons of Korah wrote, you can see that they had prophetic utterances in their psalms and they could see the Messiah. What a powerful thing to go down in history as is the guy that did not get swallowed up by the earth when your dad rebelled against God, and then you end up writing prophetic songs about the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And if you look closely at one particular psalm, I'm going to read it to you in the English Standard Version, but in Psalm 84. This is written by the sons of Korah. Sister Bush, it says, how lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, yes, faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and flesh sing for joy to the living God. And then we're going to skip down to verse 10 where the Bible says, for a day in your courts is better than 1,000 elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of wickedness. Did you catch what they sang there? Did you catch what they wrote about and what they sang about? It's not just some poetic language that they just came up that did not have any experience with it. When they sang, I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God, they were actually standing at the threshold of the tabernacle, the house of God, when their own father went against Moses and Aaron and God swallowed him up in the earth. That's where they were standing. And they came against Moses, they came against Aaron, and they were standing at the door of the tabernacle. And that verse is, I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of wickedness. Remember that warning that Moses gave him. He said, depart from the tents of wickedness. And they only needed to look back at their family history and remember how their father, Korah, had stood by those tents. And the Bible says in 16:31, the ground clave asunder that was under them, and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed them up in their houses, and all the men that appertained unto Korah and all their goods. They were swallowed up by the earth, and what they are saying here is so clear. Brother Peters, they're saying, I want to be who God wants me to be, doing exactly what God wants me to do. And Dan Dean wrote a song years ago, I want to be just like you because he wants to be just like me. I want to be a holy example for his innocent eyes to see. Help me be a living Bible, Lord, that my little boy can read. I want to be just like you because he wants to be just like me. There's an old folk tale that I think I've told you before, and I find it incredibly interesting. And I've heard it many times, and I'd like to share that story with you again this morning, if you don't mind. I hope you'll be patient with me and be kind to me as I share it. You see, once there was a little old man. His eyes blinked and his hands trembled when he ate his food. His head shook. He'd miss his mouth and he clattered the silverware distressingly, and the spoon would hit here and the spoon would hit there, and he would dribble bits of food on his clothes and on his table, on the tablecloth. And now in his old age, he is now living with his son and his daughter-in-law. He really had nowhere else to go, no one else to live with, and his son's wife, the daughter-in-law, she did not like the situation at all. She said, "I can't have this. I can't have this. It interferes with my right to happiness." So she and her husband, they took the old man, and they gently but firmly took him by the arm, and they led him to the corner of the kitchen. And there they gave him a little stool and a little table, and they put his food in an earthenware bowl that wouldn't make as much noise, and they made him eat there in the corner. And from then on, he always ate in that corner all by himself, glancing at the table time from time, and with wistful and tear-filled eyes, he would look at them and wish that he was back at the table. And one day, his hands were trembling more than they usually did, and he dropped that earthenware bowl, and it hit that tile floor and broke. And the daughter-in-law, in her cruel way, she said, "If you're going to be a pig, then you're going to eat like a pig, and we're going to make you a trough, and you're going to eat from a trough." So they made him a little wooden trough, and he would scoop his food up out of that little wooden trough and put his face down there and eat that way, all by himself. This couple, they had a 4-year-old son. They were very fond of him. They loved him. They spoiled him. They treated him quite well. And one evening, the young man, the dad, he noticed that his little boy, his 4-year-old boy, was playing with some wood, and he was making something. He was being creative. He was using his mind, and he was busy at work. And so the dad said, "Hey, what are you doing?" And the little boy looked up at his dad. He said, "Dad, I'm making a trough." With excitement, he said in his voice, "I'm making a trough." He said, "I'm making a trough so that I can feed you and feed mom when y'all get old." And he was excited because he was being just like his daddy. He was being just like his mom. And needless to say, that evening, the old man, he was brought back to the table, and nothing else was ever said about the messes the old man made or the noises the old man made. You see, it's quite amazing what a little child can see. It's quite amazing what a child can feel and what a child will hear. Jesus told us in Matthew 18, "Verily I say unto you, except you be converted and become as little children, you shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven." I want to take you back to the sons of Korah this morning, and they may not have been little boys when their daddy failed so badly. However, they had a childlike faith in God and in the ministry, and it saved their lives. You see, sometimes we need the help, and we need to hear the voice of the child that's in us. And so I ask you this morning, what does a child see? What does a child hear? What does a child feel? Yesterday, I was sitting there talking with Simon at the men's breakfast, and Logan, he was doing the different things that little boys do and should do. And it was amazing that the exact same events caused different responses according to what's going on. Because he face planted in the fellowship hall on the floor and jumped right back up and kept on going because Jacob was there entertaining. But you let somebody not see that happen, and I know from experience as a dad, that boy would look around and find somebody to cry for. And you know that you saw that in your children. And so what do they hear? What do they see? What do they feel? Getting the perspective of a child can go a long way in helping you and helping me honor God. And today we want to honor our earthly fathers, and today we want to honor our heavenly Father. And Jesus gave us a kickstart on how to do this when he prayed in Matthew chapter 6, verse 9. He said, after this manner, I want you to pray. And he said, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. So my question for myself and for you today, and think about this from the heart of a child, is do I really honor God as my heavenly Father? Do you really honor God? Tyler, I know we believe in God, and I know we say we honor God, and we praise God, and we worship God, but what about honoring him as your Father, as your heavenly Father? Hear your pastor here today. I want my life to honor God. I want my entire life to praise and worship and honor God. I want for my children, I want for Anna and Jacob to know that I love God and that I honor God. And as your pastor, I want to show you the way to live a life that honors God. Thomas Carlyle said this. He said, show me the man you honor, and I will know what kind of man you are. Show me the man you honor, and I will know what kind of man you are. You see, that little boy that I told you about in that folk tale, he loved his mom and dad so much that he wanted to emulate them. And as such, he was preparing to put them in the corner with a feed trough. Why? Because this is what he saw mom and daddy do. We have some great men here today. We have some great boys here today. We have some God-fearing men, some family men. Brother Barley, his grandchildren. Brother Newby, Brother Mars, Brother Hoffman, the list goes on. I could name all of you today some great men, godly, family-loving men. So today I honor God and I honor my heavenly Father. And I want for my life to not cause you to want to build a feed trough for me and put me in a corner. But I want for my life to say, he needs to be at the table. He needs to be at the table. You see, the sons of Korah could have decided to follow their dad, and they would have died that day, and their lineage would have ended. But they said, we honor our heavenly Father first and foremost. And like Thomas Carlyle said, show me the man you honor, and I will show you what kind of man you are. And so because of that, the sons of Korah said, we honor our heavenly Father first and foremost. They lived to tell about it, and they also lived to write songs about it. And this is something I want to point out to you today. Unless I'm horribly mistaken, Brother Newby, there's no record in history that the sons of Korah ever badmouthed their dad. And so the Bible tells us, honor your father and honor your mother. If anyone had an excuse to say something horrific about their father, the sons of Korah did. But they said, instead, we're going to write about the Messiah. Instead, we're going to sing about our service to the Lord. Instead, we're going to write about being, in the doorway of the tent of God. Because honor shows up. And if you honor God, it's going to reveal itself. Honor is obvious. If you honor a soldier, he knows it. He recognizes it. If you honor a leader, the leader can tell, and so can those around you. If you honor your dad will know it. And I want to honor my heavenly Father so much that Anna knows it and that Jacob knows it. I want to honor God so much that you know it. I want it to be so that you understand he's first and foremost. John Sobieski III, he was the king in Poland in the late 17th century. I had to pull a little of this in for you. The things we do, the gifts we give. king of Poland in the late 17th century, is best remembered as the man who saved Central Europe from the invading army of the Turks back in 1683. And with the Turks at the walls of Vienna, King Sobieski led a charge that broke the siege and his rescue of Vienna. And it's considered one of the decisive battles in European history. And in announcing his great victory, the king decided to use the words, the famous words of Caesar. And we know the famous words of Caesar. He said, "I came, I saw, I conquered." But King Sobieski, he said, "I'm not going to say that. I'm going to say, I came, I saw, God conquered. I came, I saw, God conquered. Let me go down in history as a winner who gives God all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. Allow my life to go down in history as someone who said, it didn't matter what everyone else did. He stood in the house of the Lord and honored God, his Father, all the days of his life." Amen. Mark Twain, he said, "It is better to deserve honors and to not have them than to have honor and to not deserve it. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of God than have the riches untold and be lost in sin. Let me be a man that my son can emulate. Let me be a pastor that you can emulate." You see, there's great irony in life. And the frustrated father was heard to say, "By the time a man is old enough to recognize his daddy was right, he has a son who thinks he's wrong." It's like ever overlapping. And Malachi, that Hebrew prophet who apparently recognized the power of the father-child relationship, ministering about 100 years after the Jews returned from the captivity, Malachi, he encouraged the people who had rebuilt their temple but failed to rebuild their lives and their relationships with God. They rebuilt the walls and they rebuilt their temple, but they did not rebuild what they had with God. And the priesthood was so corrupt, and worship was becoming so routine, and family destruction was widespread. Social justice was ignored, and tithing was completely neglected. And Malachi had a lot of sins that he could have preached about. And that's why it's so amazing that the last words of this prophecy, the last words that the Jews would hear from God for 400 years, the last words, Brother Logan, the last words for 400 years, this is it. We're going to have deafening silence for 400 years, and the last words are about the relationship of a father and a child. And these words are found on our final page of our Old Testament, Malachi 4:6. He said, "And he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children, and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse." Malachi is speaking about that messenger from God, the messenger who would come and ultimately direct people to Jesus and tell them about the Messiah. We know that messenger is John, and the very words that Malachi said are later repeated in Luke chapter 1 as that angelic messenger announces to John's father, Zechariah. So he told John's daddy. He said, "And many of the children of Israel shall he turn to the Lord their God, and he shall go before him in the spirit and the power of Elias to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." You see, there is a connection here of a man turning the hearts of the people to the Father. There's a connection here of a man that wants to turn the hearts of the people to the Heavenly Father. Say, turn your eyes back to God, look back to the Lord, and honor God with all of your substance, and do all that you can. And we have the sons of Korah who said, "I'll never speak a bad word of my dad, even though he was wrong, and I'm going to worship the Lord." And we have the little boy in the folktale who said, I want to be just like you, Daddy. I want to be just like you. Lord, I want to be just like you. Because he wants to be just like me. I want to close this morning by asking you to think about that. My ornery, mean as a snake, all boy son loves you. And he loves you. And I'm pointing this out because he wants so much to be like him, and I'm so much to be like him, that I need for him and for him to be like him. And my son's not the only one who does that. Your son is going to do it. And there's going to be some men in their lives. And each of us, our children and our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren, they're emulating people and they're picking up after people and they're watching people. And so he doesn't just need me to be all that I should be. He needs all the men in his life. And he needs all the men in his life. Tyler and Daniel, they need all the men in their lives.